A very good morning. You are watching Rajya Sabha television. I'm Smriti Rastogi with breakfast news. Let's begin the bulletin with the top headlines. Foundation stone for 340-kilometer six-lane Purvanchal expressway to be laid by Prime Minister Narendra Modi in Azamgarh today. On two-day visit to Uttar Pradesh, Prime Minister to also dedicate development projects worth 1,000 crore rupees in Varanasi. Exports up by 17.57% in June, reaches $27.7 billion. Petroleum products, chemicals, pharmaceuticals, gems and engineering goods register positive growth. Trade deficit widens. Annual Rath Yatra of Lord Jagannath in Puri begins. Mega festival marks journey of Lord Jagannath, Balabhadra and Goddess Subhadra from the Jagannath temple in Gundicha temple, 3 kilometers apart. 7,000 security personnel deployed to ensure security. Former Pakistan Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif and his daughter sent to jail in Rawalpindi following their arrest on arrival. 50 people injured in clashes between PMLN workers and police in Lahore. At least 133 killed and over 200 injured in multiple attacks on election rallies ahead of 25th July polls. And PV Sindhu to play Indonesian challenger in semi-finals of Thailand Open Badminton Tournament at the Wimbledon. Serena Williams and Angelique Kerber to clash for the title in women's singles today. Prime Minister Narendra Modi will begin a two-day tour of eastern Uttar Pradesh today. He will visit Varanasi and lay the foundation stone in Azamgarh for 340 kilometers Purvanchal Expressway. The Prime Minister will also inaugurate other development projects and address rallies in Varanasi, Azamgarh and Mirzapur during the tour. The projects to be launched in Varanasi alone are estimated to be worth 1,000 crore rupees. Among the projects to be dedicated are the Varanasi City Gas Distribution Project and Varanasi Balia EMU train. The foundation stone will be laid for Panchkoshi Parikrama Marg and several projects under Smart City Mission and Namami Gange. In Azamgarh, the six-lane Purvanchal Expressway will provide a smooth ride between Lucknow and Ghazipur. The project is worth 23,000 crore rupees and will be constructed in 3 years. Once this expressway is complete, Delhi will be connected via expressway to several major UP towns and cities. On Sunday, he will address a public meeting in Mirzapur. He will also dedicate the Bansagar Canal project to the nation there and laid the foundation stone for Mirzapur Medical College. Development projects worth 1,000 crore rupees will be formally launched. The country's exports have grown by 17.57% to $27.7 billion in June. The data released by the Commerce Ministry says the increase is on account of healthy growth in sectors such as petroleum and chemicals. However, trade deficit has widened to a 43-month high of $16.6 billion due to costlier crude oil imports. Imports rose by 21.31% to $44.3 billion during the month. Exports of petroleum products, chemicals, pharmaceuticals, gems and jewelry and engineering goods registered a positive growth. However, shipment of textiles, leather, marine products, poultry, cashew, rice and coffee recorded negative growth. Oil imports during the month were up by 56.61% and $12.73 billion. Gold imports in June dipped by about 3% to $2.38 billion. Vice President M. Venkaiah Naidu has called upon various scientific organizations in the country to work in synergy in order to improve people's lives. Speaking at the Indian National Center for Ocean Information Services in Hyderabad on Friday, Vice President praised scientists working in the areas of ocean observations, information and advisory services. The Vice President urged scientists to work closely with coastal states and their disaster management units to prepare the coastal communities for any eventuality. Vice President also suggested to inquest to integrate multi-hazard vulnerability maps with tsunami early warnings to give more accurate forecasts.
I have seen the multi-hazard vulnerability maps and the 3D GIS maps generated by inquest. I am sure that they will find enormous use in planning coastal infrastructure as also disaster mitigation. Meanwhile, I suggest you to integrate these maps with tsunami early warnings and storm surge predictions so that you can give a more accurate forecast of the areas that might get inundated due to tsunami or storm surge.
And Union Minister Arun Jaitley has said that while the Congress gave slogans to rural India, Prime Minister Narendra Modi actually gave them resources. In a detailed blog on Facebook, he said that NDA government's policy on rural development is clear. Jaitley also listed in detail the various initiatives taken by the centre to improve the livelihood of rural India. He wrote that a total of 14.34 lakh crore is to be spent on livelihood and infrastructure development in rural areas this year. Attacking the Congress, he wrote, the 1971 Garibi Hatao model was one of the redistribution of poverty rather than the generation of wealth and resources. On to some other news, India has invited US President Donald Trump to be the chief guest for the next year's Republic Day parade and celebrations. Trump had last year given a verbal consent to visit India during Prime Minister Narendra Modi's visit to the US. Last month, US Ambassador to the United Nations, Nikki Haley, had met the Indian officials in Delhi in this regard. And the 2+2 dialogue between India and the United States, which was postponed recently, will now be held in September. This was confirmed by Defense Minister Nirmala Sitharaman. Defense and foreign ministers of both the countries will take part in first of its kind dialogue. The agenda of the dialogue will be to further strengthen strategic and defense ties between the two countries. The United States had last month postponed the meeting for the second time. The 2+2 talks were agreed to by Prime Minister Narendra Modi and US President Donald Trump last year. And India has conveyed to Russia that it will not be a part of the project to develop a fifth generation fighter aircraft now. New Delhi conveyed to Moscow that it may join the program at a later stage. Defense Minister Nirmala Sitharaman said this has been conveyed to Russia and they can go ahead with the project. India's decision came after years of negotiations between the two countries could not yield concrete results on various contentious issues, including sharing of cost of the project. The estimated cost of the project is around 2 lakh crore rupees. India and Russia had signed an intergovernmental agreement for the mega project in 2007, vowing to take the military ties between the two strategic partners to the next level. However, the project has been stuck for the last 11 years. And the Indian Army is mulling abolishing cantonments across the country. Reports suggest that the Army has told the Defence Ministry that military areas within cantonments can be converted into exclusive military stations where the Army has absolute control, while civilian areas can be handed over to the local municipal authorities for maintenance. Reports say that the top army hierarchy feels the step will help reduce the strain on the country's defense budget for the annual maintenance of cantonments, as well as strengthen security in military stations, simplify land management and prevent encroachments. The proposal comes almost 250 years after the first cantonment to house troops was established at Barakpur by the British, and their number slowly grew to 62 over time. After a successful Swachh Sarvekshan of urban areas, the government has launched the Cleanliness Survey in the rural India. The month-long survey will begin on August 1st in all the villages across the country.
The government launched the Swachh Sarvekshan Grameen 2018, a rural cleanliness survey aiming to make every village open defecation free by 2019. The month-long first-of-its-kind survey will begin on the 1st of August. Commissioned by the Ministry of Drinking Water and Sanitation, the survey is being conducted by an independent agency which will review cleanliness in the villages and prepare a report along with ranking the districts and states. The ranking will be based on district-level surveys of public places like schools, Anganwadis, Haat Bazaars, Panchayat and perception of Swachhata among the citizens.
600-700 surveyors field में रहेंगे पूरे अगस्त के महीने में और तीन broad categories हैं जिससे कि ranking होगा एक होगा public feedback तो citizens feedback को हम 35% weight देंगे और direct observation को जो हमारे survey teams हैं उसको हम 30% weightage देंगे और जो हमारा management information system है जिसपे हमारे सारे आंकड़े हैं उसको हम 35% वेटेज देंगे सब मिलाके एक वेट होगा और एक रैंकिंग होगा
टॉप परफॉर्मिंग स्टेट्स एंड डिस्ट्रिक्ट्स विल बी अवार्डेड ऑन द 2nd ऑफ अक्टूबर अंडर द स्वच्छ सर्वेक्षण ग्रामीण 6800 विलेजेस इन 680 डिस्ट्रिक्ट्स अक्रॉस द कंट्री विल बी कवर्ड 34000 पब्लिक प्लेसेस इन दीज विलेजेस विल बी सर्वेड बेस्ड ऑन क्लीनलीनेस पैरामीटर्स As per government figures, over 72% villages across India have been verified open defecation free.
अपने जो सवाल पूछा राज्यसभा टीवी से, तो जो अन्य परियोजना है जैसे गोबर्धन है, गोबर्धन is under implementation और इसमें अभी state government से काफी dialogue हो चुका है, project select किए गए हैं और इसके details हम आपको अलग से दे सकते हैं, तो ये गोबर्धन का जो program है ये under implementation है.
A meeting of representatives of centre and states was also held on Friday. In the meeting, the states were told to prepare for the Swachh Sarvekshan Grameen. With inputs from Navikram Singh, Bureau Report, Rajya Sabha TV.
And with that, time for a very short break. More news and updates on the other side. Stay with us.
Art arisen from a multi-hued cultural canvas. Tradition and cultural fervor dating back centuries. And encircling them all, there's a magic that awes. Embrace your nation's brilliant human warmth. Watch Colors of India, Sundays at 9:30 p.m. on Rajya Sabha Television.
Welcome back. The annual Rath Yatra of Lord Jagannath in Puri is underway. The mega festival marks the journey of Lord Jagannath, Lord Balabhadra and Goddess Subhadra from their abode in Puri's Jagannath Temple to Gundicha Temple, 3 kilometers away. The coastal town temple region glowed to its finest with devotees and tourists thronging the roads on Friday. Nearly 7,000 security personnel have been deployed to ensure security of the visitors, including the devotees and the tourists. The Jagannath Temple management has made all arrangements for the smooth completion of this of the special ritual. And BJP President Amit Shah will flag off Madhya Pradesh Chief Minister Shivraj Singh Chauhan's Jan Ashirwad Yatra from Ujjain today, signalling the beginning of the party's assembly poll campaign. The Yatra will culminate on September 25th. And Chauhan is expected to cover all the 230 assembly segments in the state and address scores of rallies. The assembly polls are due in Madhya Pradesh later this year. Shah will flag off the Yatra after offering prayers at Mahakaleshwar Temple, one of the 12 Jyotirlings in Ujjain. This will be Chauhan's third Jan Ashirwad Yatra. He had embarked on similar tours ahead of the state assembly polls in 2008 and 2013. The BJP is seeking a fourth consecutive term in Madhya Pradesh, while the opposition Congress is looking to regain power in the state after a gap of 15 years. And several areas in Delhi faced waterlogging as heavy rain slashed the national capital on Friday, forcing many people to wade through knee-deep water, while a stationary bus got nearly submerged below the Minto Bridge near Connaught Place. A DTC bus got almost submerged below the Minto Bridge, a notorious catchment area in the city, as curious onlookers gathered around it. 7 to 8 occupants of the low-floor bus who were stranded were rescued by the Delhi Fire Service. And a 4-year-old boy drowned while around 250 people were shifted to safer places as rain lashed most parts of Saurashtra region in Gujarat. As a precautionary measure, around 150 people have been shifted from low-lying areas to safer parts of the city. A team of NDRF has been called from Jamnagar and it is stationed at Rajkot for emergencies. Several parts of Junagarh, Jamnagar, Devbhoomi Dwarka, Gir Somnath and Amreli districts received moderate showers in the last 36 hours. Meanwhile, heavy rainfall was also recorded in many parts of Punjab and Haryana, ending a week-long dry spell. Chandigarh received heavy downpour and the mercury dropped by a few notches. Kangra in Himachal Pradesh also received the highest rainfall as the state continued to be pawed by rains, while Kangra recorded 90.3 millimetres rain. Palampur recorded 75 millimetres in the last 24 hours. And now the international news. Pakistan's former Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif and his daughter Maryam were arrested on late Friday night. The father-daughter duo were shifted to Adiala Jail in Rawalpindi after their arrest following the conviction in one of the 3 corruption cases against the powerful political family weeks before the July 25th polls. The two were convicted on July 6th in the Evenfield Properties case linked to Sharif family's ownership of 4 luxury flats in London. At least 50 people were injured during clashes between PMLN workers and police in Pakistan's Punjab province during rallies held in connection with the arrival of Nawaz Sharif and his daughter Maryam. The protesters pelted police and rangers with stones when they fired tear gas on them. Now let's take a look at what's happening in the Football World Cup in Russia. At the FIFA World Cup, Belgium and England meet for the second time in the tournament as they clash for the third place. The Red Devils were beaten by France 1-0 before Croatia bettered the Three Lions 2-1 after extra time to set up the Saturday showdown. Both teams will still be feeling the disappointment of missing out on Sunday's final, but a win for England would ensure their best finish at a World Cup finals since 1966. And to get a wider perspective on today's match and of course the tomorrow's extravaganza, we have with us in studio Jyoti and Bharat, former national football player. Jyoti, take us through the England's and Belgium's journey. Do you think that England could have advanced further? Where did they lag?
I think England did better than expected this World Cup. They had a great tournament so far. They overcame a comparatively weaker side in Sweden and Colombia to reach the semis. But I think they were completely outplayed in the semis by Croatia. Belgium, on the other hand, have had a tougher journey to the semis. You know, they faced Brazil and they overcame a very tough opponent in Japan. So it's been a different ride for both of them. But definitely a game for both of them. They're looking to win and go back home with some sort of pride.
Which team do you think can have a better chance?
I think this is the golden generation of Belgium, and I think they do have an edge in terms of having a more talented team. England is a younger team, I think less experienced, but definitely hungrier, I feel, for this third place win. So it's going to be interesting, a battle between, you know, an experienced side with slightly more talent against a side that is slightly hungrier for this.
About tomorrow's match, what all we should look out for? What is France and Croatia's strength? Who will be the key players we should look out for?
France definitely going into tomorrow's game as favourites. You know, they're a very talented side, a side that were, you know, they were pitted to win this World Cup right from the start. Croatia have been in the dark horses, the underdogs who have done really well, you know, put up some very gritty performances in the last two to three matches. But, you know, France do have the edge, you know, superior team, I think, and they have talent in every department. Croatia, you know, great dominance in the midfield and in strike. But I think tomorrow going into the game, France do have an edge and I do see them lifting this trophy.
Thank you so much, Jyoti, for joining us and giving us all those inputs on that match which is going to take place today. And of course, the extravaganza which everybody's eyes have been set on for tomorrow. Moving on, a confident Indian side set to wrap up another series against host England in the second ODI at Lord's on Saturday. The Indian side will also close the gap between the two sides in the ICC rankings, where England is still leading after a 5-0 victory against the Australians. More importantly, ODI series win will hand over bragging rights to India ahead of the 5-Test series, which is scheduled to play in August. And in Wimbledon, it saw a scintillating day for the semi-finals at the All England Club on Friday. South African Kevin Anderson entered the final, whereas the second semi-final between the great rivals Nadal and Djokovic was suspended. The battle between the two will resume on Saturday ahead of the women's final. South African side seed Anderson won the longest ever Wimbledon semi-final against American John Isner after a play of 6 hours and 36 minutes. The second semi-final between Rafael Nadal and Novak Djokovic was suspended, with the Serbian Djokovic leading by 6-4, 3-6, 7-6. Djokovic needs one more set victory to book a Sunday showdown with Kevin Anderson. Women's final between Serena Williams and Angelique Kerber will be played at the All England Club. Kerber will face 7-time champion Serena Williams in the finals today. And Olympic silver medalist PV Sindhu progressed to the women's singles semi-final after knocking out Malaysia's Sonilia Shia in state games at the Thailand Open. Sindhu outclassed Shia in the quarterfinals, whereas the clash lasted 36 minutes. The second-seeded Indian continued her consistent performance with 21-17, 21-13 win over the number 35. Sindhu now faces Georgia Mariksa of Indonesia in the semi-finals. Prior to Sindhu's pre-quarters match, all of India's competitors lost one by one. The fourth seed Pranoy lost to Indonesian qualifier Swoni in the shocking 18-21, 14-21 in 35 minutes, while 2012 Olympian Kashyap went down fighting to Japanese Kanta The men's singles pair of Manu and Sumit had lost to Japanese combine of Haruyuki and Yuta 24-22, 13-21, 19-21 in an hour and 6 minutes. And before we leave you, gold coins belonging to 12th century have been found during earth digging for a road construction in Chhattisgarh's Kondagaon district. A pot containing 57 gold coins, a silver coin and a gold earring was unearthed on July 10th during the construction of the road between Korkoti and Bedma villages. As per the preliminary investigation, the coins date back to 12th and 13th century. The State Archaeological Department will examine the coins further. Thank you for watching Breakfast News.